Right, welcome everybody. Thank you all for coming. It's my great pleasure today to award the 2023 Shirley Phillips No-Till Award. Most of you will know we've had this award in our department for a number of years now, I think probably two decades. We've got plaques outside my office that have the name of every person, every recipient of the award. And it's obviously given to honor Shirley Phillips and the adoption of no-till in here in the state of Kentucky. And so today it's my great honor to present this award to Mr. Rankin Powell. Rankin. We do have a committee for this award. So you were nominated by Chad and you had competition and you won. So congratulations, Rankin.
So what we thought we would do is, one, we've got some folks on Zoom that are on as well. We've got some visitors in Western Kentucky that made the trip in today also for your ranking. And I thought we would go through a bit of a question and answer session with Rankin. He's had a lot of years of experience. He's seen a lot of things. And as soon as I get my notes out, somebody decided to zip this thing. Me. Well, I don't believe you need a note. No, I don't think so. I'm the one that needs those on this. So let's give if we can, just a little bit of a background on some of this. And so let's start out. I mean, Rankin is receiving this award because he's considered a pioneer in no-till ag in Kentucky. And we'll explain a little bit more of that as we go through. Most of us in the room, you know Rankin from his role as the Union County Ag Extension Agent. He worked in Union County for about 19 years, give or take. But his story in no-till with UK and ag begins way, way before that. So he graduated from this department with a Master's of Science degree in 1964. He worked here in this area when this whole area was the research farm. So the only building on this side of the road at that time, Scott, was the Cooper House, which is being restored. And as you told a couple of the groups, you most of your research was by the water tower, which I believe Edwin got you over to.
Took my picture out there in the bluegrass sod, which we worked with. Probably some of the same sod still there. From I think we started that in 1961. Yeah. So anyway, that was it's been a trip for this morning, Ted. I appreciate it. Thank you for nominating me, and it's my pleasure to be here with all you distinguished professors who have been my role models for so many years, and Chairman McCauley, my wife, and two people from that I've been used to work with, and Annette and Jessica from all drove all the way up here from Union and Henderson County for this, and I really appreciate that. Anyway, it's been my pleasure. I've been going all morning. Ted had all kind of nice schedule for me, and the highlight was meeting your students. I had lunch over here across the hall with the students, the young, smiling faces. That's our future. And all of them clean cut and, you know, didn't look like they were halfway on dope or anything. But the kind of young people that we like to see carrying on our future. That was a highlight of my morning. Now, you want me to go back on any more of this stuff about the information and stuff, about what we did here and so forth?
That's the question, Chad.
Dad's heard this about 10 times.
I'm sorry. I was getting a text as well from Katie out in Union County. They're saying they can't see us on the...
Yeah, I think the...
camera is broken so they can hear you.
You can hear you. Okay. All they're looking at is the podium, Chad, unfortunately.
Okay. So, Katie, you can't see us. You just get to hear us. And for my situation, that's your best case scenario. And so we apologize for that part of it. So you've gone through some of this. Let me couple other things here that you made comments on, and you just tell me if these are, if I heard these right and such. So when he was in grad school, when they talked about, he talked about planting some of the no-till plots, you actually planted the very first no-till corn on campus, and you did it with a modified drill that later became known as, that that design took off and became known as the John Deere power drill, power till drill, which I found on Tractor House. You can still buy one for about $1,500 right now. It's, that's what the bid is currently on it. And so that drill, you told us you made banded applications with paraquat and basically did almost like a strip till with the way that that thing was set up. The time he was here, there were some changes on campus at that time. So he helped move equipment into the brand new Ag Science Center North. At that time.
Today, I'm glad that Ted came to get us, because I wouldn't have known where to come. It's been a long time and the buildings didn't exist, you know. I would come up Cooper Drive and went over across the way, and I thought that auditorium over there, which is C auditorium, was the Cameron Williams auditorium. But, you know, anyway, I'm here. And things do change over the years. And Edwin took me on a little tour of the campus, and we went out to the water tower. And so that was a big, big, big thing for me today. And big thing, biggest thing for me is seeing all you people, and thank you for coming. And I'm ready, or Ted, ready to answer any questions that you might have. And I've been answering them all morning, and some of you have heard my answers several times, so you could answer them if you want to. Like Olaf was telling about this chauffeur that was gave the Nobel Prize winner a speech. You know, y'all heard that story. Okay. Yeah. So I was about the same way. Excuse me. Dr. Henning.
So, Rankin, you left here in 1963, and you went...
Oh, 1964. Yes.
So what happened next?
Well, the Kentucky Department of Highways interviewed people on campus. So Kenneth Franks, I was working with Dr. Taylor mostly. Kenneth Franks was working with Dr. Templeton. Of course, Warren Thompson was the extension specialist and worked with him. And Kenneth Franks and I both went over to Frankfort to start a new highway roadside development agronomy program for the state of Kentucky. And at that time, the parkways and the interstates were being built. And I enjoyed that work. We wrote what they call the erosion control notes on all the contracts that were let, and went out and made sure that the contractors put what they supposed to out. And we caught a lot of that. And especially on the Bluegrass Parkway and the West Kentucky Parkway, because they were trying to cut costs and make extra money off the state, to tell you the truth. So one instance, and by the way, that's where I met my wife, Dolly. She was working over there too. And down in Paducah there, around the Kentucky Dam Village parking lot, they had let a contract. They were supposed to put bluegrass sod in there. There's not as much of the sod part now as it was back then. And the highway department, chief of the highway department anyway, Henry Ward, who was next year was candidate for governor, didn't win. But anyway, he called me up and said, "Now, we're going to have the National Governors Conference meeting in Kentucky Dam Village, and they just built those new department building tech cabins down there. Said, now, I want that parking lot to look green." So I went down there, got a hold of the, he said, "You can have all the highway department people you want to work, all the parks department people." And we went over and we found some Bermuda grass sod out there at the edge of the golf course. We dug it up, took it up there, laid it out there, and I stayed there for 2 weeks in a motel room, and I watered it day and night. And and by the time they came off from all over the United States, it was green. And that was my experience over beside first thing after leaving here. And Lieutenant Franks, by the way, he retired from that job. I was there about a year and a half, and Dr. Bohannon, if y'all know, remember him, he was an assistant dean for agriculture or something, and he had an office right in the lobby, or almost in the lobby of the old Ag Science Center there. I remember Dr. Bo's desk was clean, had nothing on it, maybe one little fire cabinet. That was his office. I came down the hall one day, he said, "Hey, boy, come in here." "Yeah, Dr. Bo, I got a job for you." You know. So I said, "Well, I was over here all the time because I worked for the state, you know, over here quite frequently." So he offered me a job in with the TVA program, and I took that. He had offered me a job before I went over to Frankfurt, but I said, "No, no, boy, I just don't think I'd come for that salary." You know, at that time, it was like $5,000 a year if you had a master's. Not that much if you didn't, you know. So, and so the state guy offered us, you know, $6,000 a year. So, but time to change. Things are a little more expensive now. But anyway, I went there, and Dr. Bowles said, "I'd offer you more money now." So I said, "Okay." So he offered me $8,000 a year, and to work on this TVA program and do this testing, tracing farms that I don't know if any of y'all are, some people have heard of it, some people have not. The TVA had a research center in Muscle Shoals, Alabama, and they were a research fertilizer manufacturer, and they had a forage farm there. They had a lot of, I went down there a time or two, and we got some Bermuda grass sod to plant in farmers that we could get to do it, you know. And so, and I was able to talk the TVA people into buying me a 2-row Alice Chamber no-till drill. And I could pull behind my pickup truck, take it out to farmers and try to get them to try it, you know. And also, was working in other TVA counties too, so I talked to agents in other counties, and they had somebody who was going to try to get somebody putting some out. So we did, worked on that, and it was a hard sell, really a hard sell. We had to drill. So next off, TVA said, "Well, we'll give them the fertilizer for it." But we had dry fertilizer, give them that. And then,
question real quick, what year was this? 66, maybe 66. Okay, so
1966, Harry Young planted his first no-till corn plot in 1962. So you're getting a sense of how early on this is in the process.
Mm-hmm. And so Peter Phillips, who was working with Harry Young a lot, he said, "Well, he was able to obtain us enough seed corn to furnish the farmer the drill, the seed corn, and the fertilizer. All he had to do was furnish a tractor to pull it with and spray it." Now, that last part was not easy. But anyway, we got it going, and it really took off down in West Kentucky there. And then after 2 or 3 years there, going on pretty good, we hit a lull. I thought, "Uh-oh, this is going to be the end of no-till for how, as we, it would never happen, I don't think." They got paraquat registered, which I've worked on with Dr. Taylor up here, plant putting out our plots. Oh, home plot, okay. And anyway, that was a saving thing at that time for no-till, because farmers were putting on 3 pounds of simazine, 3 pounds of atrazine to control the vegetation, and you couldn't plant anything with corn there, you know. So they were killing the ground almost. So we got that, lasso came along, we got that, and then we got the paraquat registered, and no-till took off. And that was really great. And any other questions? Now, I think I brought, have I missed anything here, Chad?
You're doing great.
You're going good, okay. So, did work there for the TVA program for 5 years, and then the funding for that program ceased. Monroe Resnick worked for them a while longer, but they didn't get to it. And I don't think his funding was full time and so forth. But anyway, the program as we knew it, and it was a very good program. The purpose of it was, excuse me.
You're ready to say it. Go ahead and say it. I was going to ask, was it all for erosion control? What was the purpose of the program?
Why was there a TVA program?
Okay. The TVA agriculture program was to help to relocate and get people to doing something to were relocated when they built the dam system in the Tennessee River and the Cumberland River. Farmers that were displaced their land, you know, they took their land, they flooded it, and they moved out in these other counties, and we were helping them get started and going again. And it was like a total program. We had a ag economist and agronomist, and we would go out, and the county agent in the county would spot us some people thought we could work with, and we'd go out and plan the entire farm, starting with the soil, what we could grow, and then putting the livestock that it could be consumed by, and everything, it worked out like it should. And that was before we had the Ohio Valley, before we had the farm analysis program. We did the same thing that they're about doing now back then. And worked out great. I remember we one place there, and we have access to all the specialists at Princeton and here. And I think we made some real success, and it really was heartwarming. And you could see something, your results of your work, whenever these guys that were really weren't doing too good, and we planned and they followed the recommendations and they succeeded and they became top-notch individuals in their field. And that's what it's for. And they figured, I guess, about, you know, budget cuts and all that stuff, that they ceased the program. And then the other part was the finance of grind thing, who Dr. John Raglan of the department here helped me set up. And we were working on that in that program when I was working on the TVA thing and after that film. And the rock quarry there was not able to very easily meet the specifications for the fineness of ground of limestone. So Reed Crushstone, Clyde Reed, I don't know, some of you may have known him, fifth grade education, multimillionaire. But anyway, he helped fund this program that I was working on to get this research done. And after 5 years, we concluded, and it was fine, he concluded that he could give, a farmer needed 2 ton, he could give him the 3 ton, and he could put that on. And they would do the same thing as 2 ton, only it lasts longer. And so that's how he got rid of that mountain of lime over there he had. It was a mountain, it really was. And so that worked out. And question? Yes, Earl.
I'm curious, during your career, what were the moments that you look back to that you can say, I had a really good cooperation with scientists on campus? So regardless whether they were teaching and research faculty or extension faculty. So what were those key experiences for you where you really think you had a good cooperation?
Okay, I think I understood that. How did I cooperate with people on campus?
Yeah, he's wanting to know how you cooperate with people on campus, maybe who those people were, examples of where things worked well. And campus and Princeton both, I assume?
Yes.
And, well, we just call them up, you know, and tell them we have this problem and that we need help. And so they were really good about coming on down. And of course, they were really liked the Total Farm program that we had with TVA. And then we continued on after that. And we couldn't have had a better group to give us assistance. Our old agronomy department. Well, sorry.
Nope.
Used to be around the car. Anyway. And they did a wonderful job. And we had, y'all remember Curtis Absher? He just came to work at Princeton as a beef cattle specialist. So he was closed. We had a swine specialist over there, tobacco specialist, soil specialist. Lloyd Murdoch came to work about a year and a half after I started. And helped me with the lime plots, you know, and that was the first time I'd met him. He was a young, you know, professor, and
he's on the screen now.
We
can see Lloyd up there. He's joined us today.
Oh, yeah.
I can't see that. That's okay. Cool. And all those people up there, I'm sure, are great people. I know they are. And by the way, making a short story, I mean, a long story short, it's been a real pleasure working for the University of Kentucky, the Plant and Soil Science Department, the Extension Service. Dr. Henning there was our boss for a long time, and we enjoyed working with him. He understood extension because he'd been in extension, you know, and that's what it takes, and the cooperation of the people in the county. And the students this morning at dinner there, they said, now, what would you do, what advice would you give us if we wanted to get a job as county extension agent in a county in Kentucky? What would the first thing you do? I said, okay. I said, well, I'd go out and then meet with the councils. The main one is county extension council. And then you'd have breakouts there for agriculture, 4-H. And family science. Well, when you have the meeting, you break out with the agriculture and you just ask them, what would you, that's program planning, what would you like for me to work on? Okay, so write it all down. And you do that as closely as possible. No offense for administration, even though the administration may not want you to be doing that, but you do it. And you and your people are always back you. You know. So. Yes, ma'am.
What's the largest change you've seen in extension over the course of your career?
The changes that I probably didn't adapt to very well, Ms. Dean Smith, was all these reports, you know. And I probably, you know, missed some raises because I didn't get the reports in on time. But I was told, I got found out, you know, that they really read them at the end of the year. And that's where they got their information on what you did. So I just, first off, when I went to Union County, we didn't have the money you have now. The counties didn't used to have any money much. Now they do. They're fine. But so they would not going to read them till July of the next year. So we had a treasurer that worked at the bank. It was really working really hard, Mickey Moore. But that was before Annette did that. Anyway, she was trying to get everything into a CD and keep it as long as she could. And we wouldn't, right before, about this time of year when the taxes came in, we'd be almost out of money. So I told her, I said, Mickey, I said, I don't really need my expense account right now. So you just wait, I'll just wait on that and we won't have to cash the CD and we'll get the tax money in and go ahead. And so I never did brag about Dr. Smith how much money I saved the county, but how much more interest they got because of that. But and it kind of made me push back a little bit, and I didn't get it done as well as I should. And I have regretfully that I didn't do that. But, you know, like I said earlier, talking with you, I was brought up to not toot my own horn. So you work hard, and you don't have to brag on yourself. Other people will know you do. And so.
All right. Well, we're going to make you talk more about yourself after you just told us you're not supposed to. So there is a restored planter, Alice Chalmer 333 planter that survived the tornado at Princeton that you donated. So why don't you give us the story behind that planter, when you bought it. I believe you were still in Livingston County at the time. Yeah. And had bought a farm there in Livingston County.
It's a TVA program. And well, and so I bought an old farm before I went down there. Just happened so that I live in Livingston County, and this fella had a farm in the paper advertised in Livingston County. So I was going the first of the year, and this was along about November, December, something. So I went and looked at it, met him over at McDonald's on the Henderson Strip. Maybe not the same building, but the same place. Made a deal. So to go down there, and I bought that farm before we went. And the man elected to tell me a few things about it. It was in the cold time of the year, but that farm was full of snakes. Bad snakes, rattlesnakes and copperheads, you know. Anyway, I still got it. And we worked there at the extension office, and I needed some extra income. So had some farmers around there that had some pretty good hogs. So built some fences, and I've had some sows and pigs. Dolly helped me with, and I'd be gone in the summer I've been the Army Reserve summer camp. She took care of those. And one time they met you out to the road, right? The pigs, they'd gotten out. And she put a sickly pig in the car and take it down to the house and nurse it back to being healthy and take it back out there. And so anyway, we did that. And I had some pretty good pigs, so I was working with a 4-H agent, and well, which most of the time was me, and Karen Ramage. Y'all remember her? She was in administration here.
Yeah.
And she came as the Farm and Consumer Science agent while I was there, about the time that went over from being in the TVA program to being an ag agent. The agent there at that time was retiring. And so they asked me to stay, and I did. And so Karen came, and we did not have a 4-H agent. Didn't have any money for it. Didn't have any money. We got, we had a maximum of $65 a month travel expenses, and don't matter how much you spent, or I mean, how much you got $65 a month. That was it, budget-wise. So another experience thing in extension, I don't know if y'all want to hear all this stuff or not, but it's historical. Anyway, the thing about it was that county didn't have the district tax. And so Karen and I went around, and we made some presentations to try to get some support for it. It didn't go too well. I said, well, I'm going to work on this, take about 2 or 3 months or more, however long it takes, and I'm going to work on it. And we're going to get this done, or I'm probably going to see if I transfer. Because Annette and Jessica both worked really good with the horse program in Union County, but Livingston County had a good horse program too, except everything they did was on Saturday afternoon and Sunday. Every meeting, and they expected us to be there every meeting. And that was, you know, I don't mind working when done a lot of corn yield contests and all that stuff on Saturday and Sunday, but every Saturday and Sunday, you know. And so I said, well, we're going to get the money for a 4-H agent. So we did. And so how did I do that, Dr. Smith? You know that you get known in the county, you know the people, you go out and meet with them. We went around to farms in and visited and rode the tractors with them. Back then, they didn't have any cab tractors. You had to hang on to the fender over there or on the wheel or something. And like the old guy that had several children, they wanted to ride the tractor with him, so he duct taped them on there, you know, the tractor so they could ride with him. Okay. Anyway, I found out, you know, somebody pushes everybody's button. Y'all agree with that?
Yes.
Okay, so I found out who pushed each magistrate's button, got in with them, got them to persuade the magistrates to vote for the district tax, and every one of them swore they wouldn't vote for any new taxes. And we came up, we had that old courthouse upstairs, summertime, hot, and came up there and presented that, and every one of them voted for it. So we got that put in. And our leadership was there, and I came out the front door, and this old guy said, "You're walking like you're 10 foot tall." I said, "I feel like it too, you know." But anyway, that was a great extension experience. And then Dr. Henning knows about the other great extension experience I had outside the box in Union County with the Shawneetown Bridge.
Yes.
They let a contract to work on the Shawneetown Bridge. We had a lot of farmers that worked land in Illinois and in Union County, and they had to move their machinery across the bridge. The highway department engineers at Madisonville district office were older fellows like me now, but maybe not as old as I am now, but older. They didn't remember that you can't get modern machinery through 11-foot opening on a bridge. So there was a big controversy there, and TV people were all down and everything. And so the highway department guys asked me to help them, kind of be a go-between between them and the farmers. And so we worked out a deal anyway to put a ferry in beside the bridge, and farmers could put their equipment on that and take it on the other side of the river. And so our first day, we had a lot of good UK graduates there and farmers, and this one guy, and he had the longest tractor, biggest tractor with the most disc and cultivators and color packers and stuff on the back of it. I said, "Bring that down there." So he brought it down, and it just barely would fit on the ferry, but it went across. And so after that solved that problem. The contractor was asking the state $1.5 million and another year almost to get that done, have them taken off their equipment off the bridge for two parts of a day a week so farmers could get back forth. They got that ferry for, I believe, for the whole summer until they got open for 75,000. So, you know, worked out well for the state of Kentucky and for the farmers and other people. And after the bridge opened and we were not able to have the ferry anymore, farmers, they wanted to keep the ferry. And it wasn't just farmers, there was other people with wide equipment and long and equipment and so forth. And, you know, that's another time that you felt good, you know. And so, yes, sir, Edwin.
Tell them about your work with the Paraquat.
Okay, yeah. Paraquat, I haven't gone over that story here today yet, but, you know, I'm a little bit older, and if I repeat something, stop me, Ted, and I won't say it again. But anyway, well, my work here at with the Masters was, I got out of the Army and came up here in like March the 1st or something like that. And Dr. G.T. Webster was the chairman of the Agronomy Department. Jack Height was next, and Dr. Smith, along in there. But Dr. Webster said, "Well, you can just work for us here, Grandpa, on the farm and around." And so I did. And you can choose which section of the Agronomy Department that you would like to work with your master's on. So I chose Dr. Taylor, Tim Taylor, because one reason, I liked all of them. I went around the state helping with the corn plots and the soybean plots and all things that we did. And I went to Eden Shale, the other counties around it had plots in. And Dr. Taylor had, his wife was from France. Anyway, he met her in World War II, and he visited over there some, and he noticed that they was working with paraquat in France, and Chevron Chemical Company was head paraquat at that time, but it was not registered in the United States. So we got some grant money to work on it here on this Spring Station farm with the strip-till and band-sprayed pasture renovation. And then it wasn't available again until we were almost thought that how had I gone through that where was the extension? I mean that I thought that no-till was almost gone.
You mentioned,
and then that's when our paraquat was registered, and I was proud to have had a part in working on that, I've been proud to have worked for UK in general.
So to make no-till work, you had to have herbicide options that were going to be part of it. And I think I asked you about your planter at one point. So I'm going to tell the story. You tell me if I got it right. So when you were in Livingston County and you had somebody else helping you decide to grow row crops on that farm, you wanted to do no-till. He didn't. You agreed that if you got the planter together, that would start no-till.
One of the farmers wanted to, it was coming out of the soil bank, this whole farm. One field one year, one field next year, and on, And so when all of them came out, he said, I'd like to put that in crop for a couple of years or something. We'd like to, I said, okay, on one condition, we'd no-till it. Well, didn't know, I said, well, we'll go in heifers. And we'll buy a planter. We never found one because they weren't very available at that time. And found one over at Fredonia, a real small Alice Timber dealer. And so that's where I got the planter. And the fellow, we ended up with two planters, and I took one when I left and went to Henderson County Farm. He kept one there. And so that's the planter that you see in the picture that's planted, sitting down by the new building in Princeton. And Chad, I'm very proud of that planter. The building fell on it and nothing broke but the plastic seed boxes, And it came through the tornado.
And when we first saw the aftermath of it and saw the roof sitting on top of the planter, we thought, uh-oh. But barely a scratch on the actual metal of the planter. Even the restored paint looks pretty good on it. So you started out with the TVA in Livingston County dragging a two-row planter behind a truck. I'm sure it met all the DOT standards of the day when you were taking that thing from farm to farm.
And county to county.
So you're all over that area.
Any county.
And then you had your own planter on your own operation. And then for the sake of time, you ended up going back to Henderson and took over your dad's farm for about 20 years.
Sure.
And you put that into no-till in that process.
I've been no-till since the 60s. That farm, I still have the farm. And the funniest thing about it, of course, Livingston County adapted it fairly quick. Union County, where I went, and Henderson County hadn't adapted no-till very much. And so I had this field along a farm to market road, 145 coming out of Cardin to Little Dixie to Pool. Not familiar with those little old towns. But anyway, I had this fence along this black top road, and it had trees on it, but they weren't solid. There would be a skip here, in the gap between trees. And so I came down through there planting corn with that no-till. And I've noticed these pickup trucks and cars, they slow up, they almost run into each other, watching what I was doing. And I'm sure they thought that crazy guy, I don't know what the heck he's doing out there. So, okay. And then in a little while, they came back by and they saw that corn coming up out there, you know. And they're looking again. And then it came on up and made a good crop. And but nobody ever asked me about it or what I was doing. But I know they were, they could see, you know. Now what? Oh, another thing. I happen to have a creek bottom farm and overflows. And the one thing no-till's really hurt me on, because all these farmers started no-tilling up a creek, and I'm not getting as much settlement every year on my creek bottom farm as I used to. I don't get as much topsoil anymore. Anyway, I'm glad I don't, but anyway.
Well, that's so you're looking at it, basically it's a career, but it's also a lifetime. You started here at UK looking at no-till when no-till was brand new. You help farmers in Livingston County, neighboring counties, get used to the idea of no-till. Your own farm ended up being in some ways a demonstration farm for others, because they may not ask you what's going on, but they were watching it and then eventually switching over to it. And so all through your career, and you probably, just from the outside looking in, you've done a very good job of navigating having your own private operation and not letting that compete with your roles at the university and vice versa, to where most of the farmers that I know look at your situation as being a positive, because they didn't perceive you as a competitor against them. They knew that you were for them, even though you had your own private operation just across the county line. That in and of itself is a phenomenal balance to reach. That's very difficult to do. I think a couple of other comments we need to make. I mean, you're here today because of your efforts in no-till, your impact on no-till around the state, around the region. That's what the award is for. But because you are up here, we do need to mention, I don't see Ben in the room at the moment, but we do need to mention that Rankin and Dolly have been very generous to the university overall. You mentioned that the no-till planter was one. There was, I'm just going to tell a personal story real quick. At one of our field days at Princeton, Rankin had told me, I'm going to get you a list of names of farmers that can give to this grain and forage center. They got money, and don't let them tell you they don't. And so he at the field day, he hands me what I thought was a card with a bunch of names of farmers. And we printed up these cards for donation, you know, for your commitments and such. And so I thought I was going to get this card with a lot of names on it. Well, what it was a card with his name on it and his check on it. At the time, Marcy was here, and I called up Marcy and I said, I've got what I thought was a good sized check that I don't know if I should have a hold of or not. What do I do at this point? So it was my first time I realized that Rankin was and Dolly were thinking about giving some to the university as well. Part of that, we need to comment that they now have in the Cooper House, the newly renovated Cooper House, the conference room that overlooks what will be the new and improved ag campus and such is the Powell family conference room. And then the demonstration classroom at Princeton will be the Powell family demonstration room as well. We actually had the sign done and scheduled to be shipped to Princeton when the tornado hit. So the sign's good. It made it. And then that'll be put in as well. And so, you know, your commitment to agriculture, your commitment to the farmers, your commitment to UK is a phenomenal example for all of us. And I think what we'll do, if you're okay with it, for this last little bit, we're going to stand up over here by the podium so at least the folks online can at least see you for a little bit, if that's all right. Are you good with that?
What's that now?
Do you mind if we stand up by the podium?
Oh,
okay. Well, at least folks online have been very patient to to stare at a blank space here and not see the guy speaking. Or can you see us now? Okay.
But a bit taller, and we.
I can sit if I need to.
Yeah, got a lot of pictures that way too, with both of us standing there, and that was interesting. But never did I regret a day that I worked for UK, and most of the time it wasn't work for me. It was just like I enjoyed doing it.
All right.
And, didn't matter. I didn't care if Farmer called me at any time, day or night. Excuse me. I had my phone on me, and I always liked to try to answer them, try to follow up, and did that thing that I recommend to your students. You meet with your committee. You try to program, plan, and do what they want done. If you do that, they'll have your back.
Chad, can you hear me?
Yes. Lloyd Murdoch. Got you, Lloyd.
Yeah, I just want to say that I've worked with Rankin for all the time that I've been in Kentucky. And he was a people person. He was a farmer's friend. And he was a hands-on person. And he not only taught those farmers, but he taught those young specialists that came to Princeton. I got schooled by him a couple of times, and he was really good. You come out of the university and you're trying to talk to farmers that has so much more experience than you do, and you don't know exactly how to handle them, and sometimes you're just a little bit backward and bashful and don't get out and make a strong point because you're concerned about whether you're right or wrong. And he would get me and say, he said, okay, now let me tell me exactly about this problem that he had heard me say and talk about. And I'd say, well, I answered it this way because he says, if you know the answer, say it. just get it out and put it out there because they want to know. He says, they're not worried about all this other stuff. So he schooled us. And I can remember going down those roads in Livingston County. And we would be going somewhere to some field or some experiment that we were putting out. And those farmers absolutely loved him. I mean, they would get up and they would wave from that tractor. And one of them wasn't sure he saw him. And he got up on his tractor seat and started waving. And Rankin just waved back and went on past. I mean, he talked about his successes of working with people and changing their lives and changing the way that the extension was received and the money they got. But he did that because that's who he was, that he was a farmer's friend. He made things happen. So I cherish all the time that I spent with him.
Thank you. Bill, I guess you got your hand up. Bill Witt.
Oh, Bill Witt. Hey, Bill, how you doing, buddy?
You're muted.
Tell him to unmute.
He's muted right now.
You're on mute, Bill.
Oh, I'm on mute or no, Bill? Bill.
Hey, Bill, you're on mute. Me? Now we got you.
Okay.
Now can you hear me?
I like okay. What I hear.
All right. Hey, I just want to echo what Lloyd said about helping young people when they started. I'll never forget when I showed up at Princeton as a weed science specialist. I thought I knew everything, and it took about 2 months to figure out I knew nothing. And people like you really helped me a lot, and thank you for that, and being a friend for many years.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Everybody honors me with your presence. Anybody honors me with your presence, and it's been one of the better days of my life. Of course, the first time we got married to my wife, and then we had our daughter, and I guess today is the third best day I've had.
Wow. I'm going to ask, did anybody else on Zoom have some thoughts or comments?
Vicki has something in the chat. Can you read it?
Yeah.
She said that she worked with Rankin as a fellow A&R agent, and she met him when she was a crop consultant from Miles Farm Supply, and would like to know what you see as the biggest change in agriculture through your career.
So Vicki Shadrick, one, appreciates the chance to work with you, and she wants to know what you think the biggest change in agriculture is going to be or has been throughout your career. What's been the biggest change in agriculture throughout your career?
Well, been a lot of big changes, and I understand it's going to be much more as it keeps going on. And that's a tough question. Maybe somebody back in the audience can answer that. You know, like I was telling about the Nobel Prize winner's chauffeur asking. But let me think a little bit on that. Of course, we talked about the drones. I think no-till has been great, but of course, that's well adapted now. The change is, I don't know right offhand, but it's all been great, and it will be better as time goes on. What do you think about that, Dr. Henning or Dr. Smith? What's the biggest change you've seen?
Well, tobacco's got to be in there somewhere, tobacco program. But
the change in tobacco, just the tobacco program. And yeah.
As far as the College of Ag goes, I would say no-till has to be one of the important historical developments in the last 50 years.
Tobacco sent a lot of people to college, me included, you know.
Right. Rankin, I want you to not feel bad about not getting those reports done.
Yeah.
You wouldn't be getting this award today if you'd been in the office doing reports all day.
That's right. You got that right. Damn. I got another little personal side story that I know, don't want to keep you people too long. You've been here about an hour. But I just wasn't able to do reports in the daytime when they went to be putting the reports on the computers. Had too many people coming in the office, too many phone calls, and it was first reports you put it on a computer. If you didn't complete this thing, it time out on you. So it happened to me all the time. I mean, I'd get started and somebody come in, and farmer, and I want to give them my attention, or somebody called, and man, it was, I got frustrated on that. So I'd come in at night, and then they got to seeing my vehicle down at the office at night, so they'd come in and even lock the door, knock, bang on the door. Want to talk, you know. So then I moved by parking around the back of the building, you know. Needless to say, reports didn't go too well.
Personally, I'm planning to use that comment, Ray, on the next set of reports. I'm too busy out in the field doing extension.
I remember one time Dean Smith was talking somewhere and said something about me not doing reports and Ken Wells not doing reports. Is that right? Dr. Ken Wells.
Was that Kiwanis Breakfast down there somewhere? But
Kiwanis Breakfast.
I'm going to claim that I said, but they were still two of the best extension people we had, and we knew it.
Yeah, well,
that's the way I remember.
I'll apologize to you right now, I'm Dr. Henry, for not getting those reports. Okay.
All right. I got one more.
I think Katie wanted to say something on.
Oh, yeah. Katie?
Can you go? I guess you guys can hear me. Okay, perfect. So there's a few producers that were unable to attend today. So they just wanted to tell you, Rankin, thank you very much for everything that you have done with Union County. And the first time I met Rankin was at my reception. And the first thing that he asked me was, are you planning on staying very long in Union County? And so I have stayed around, and now hopefully I can work on as many years as Rankin has, but maybe not, but hopefully. But again, we just here at Union County would like to thank you for all that you have done. And like I said, the producers, they wish they would have been here, but they couldn't. So they wanted to make sure that I got on, and thank you for all of your hard work and time that you gave to Union County.
All right. Thank you, Katie. I think that's a good way to wrap it up overall, Rankin. Thank you. Oh, okay.
Katie, thank you very much. I appreciate it. And I appreciate Jessica and Annette attending. And we've got Union County and Henderson County is now covered. We've got good ag agents, 4-H agents. I think Union, have y'all got a Farm and Consumer Science agent yet?
Union?
Have you got a Farm and Consumer Science agent yet? No. Okay. But Katie, see, every time I'd see her, I'd ask her, I said, how long are you going to stay? Because there's been, what, 3 or 4 between me and her.
Since 2008.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you.
All right. Rankin, thank you. And thank you all. Have a good afternoon and a good weekend.